Hi, welcome to this week's special edition of the Shtick. This is the last show we'll be doing for the next 4 weeks, and we're really very happy to have as our guest this week Rabbi Yaakov Glasman.
Hi.
You can call me Yaakov.
That's I do call you Yaakov. I wasn't sure how to start you off.
Congregants call me Yaakov, that's fine.
And you know why?
Why is that?
Because you're that kind of guy.
Oh, thank you, Henry. I appreciate that. And thank you for having me on your show. It's a wonderful honor. You've been doing the shtick for, what, 11 years now?
Mm-hmm.
That's a fantastic accomplishment.
It's actually 11 years this month.
That's amazing. Well, Kola, I feel honored to be in that 11th year. It's Kola Kavod to you.
And I feel like I deserve 4 weeks off.
Yeah, I could imagine. I hope you enjoy it.
Now, we usually take about 8 to 10 weeks off every year.
Fantastic.
We have a summer break and a winter break. And when it's freezing now, I'm going to Israel.
Oh, no better place on earth.
Mm. And you're you're senior rabbi.
Some call it senior rabbi, some call it chief minister. I think it depends which generation you belong to.
That's right. You're not minister anymore. We don't call them ministers.
No. But I'm the senior rabbi at the StKilda Hebrew congregation, or what I call StKilda Shule, and loving it. Loving every day, every moment. It's a beautiful, beautiful experience and a wonderful congregation, and been there now for about 3.5 years.
You're the youngest senior rabbi. I know, I just found out a minute ago that you're 35 years old.
Well, don't hold it against me. You're not going to be ageist or anything, are you?
No, not at all. No, I'm not, as you know. And what's your background? Were you brought up in a religious home?
Yeah, well, look, I'm an Aussie, first of all, third-generation Australian. My grandparents came from Europe after the war, and they were all survivors of the Holocaust. Both my parents were born in Melbourne in 1956, good old Olympics at Melbourne, as you'll know.
Yeah.
I also, together with all my siblings, were born in Melbourne. And what can I say? I'm a Aussie born and bred. I even barrack for Collingwood to prove that, which is usually where my interviews, that's usually where things start going backwards. But we're not doing badly this year. We could have done better against Hawthorn, but that's a separate discussion.
But we loved the end, the linking of the arms for Phil Walsh.
Oh, I thought that was...
I had shivers on my shivers.
Yeah, look, I think that was a special moment. And I think that, it highlights the issues surrounding domestic violence in general.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that's something perhaps we'll talk about later on in the program.
Just a little bit further down the line, because we've got a few things to talk about with you.
By all means.
And StKilda Shule, when was it established? That's another thing we want to know.
Oh, now you're testing my background knowledge. Look, I wasn't around at the time. The congregation was established in 1871. And it was actually operating in a synagogue, in a shul, not where the current shul stands on Sharnwood Grove, but actually opposite, I think it's on Sharnwood Crescent. So it was in the same vicinity, same area, but across the road. That building no longer exists, and it's now, I think, apartment houses. But I actually have a fascinating photograph of the interior of the old shul, which was taken around Rosh Hashanah time back in the day. But the congregation outgrew the premises at the time. And in 1927, it built the new premises, which the current shul is located on 12 Sharnwood Grove.
And it's a magnificent building.
Oh, it's stunning.
Now, I brought you in. I saw an article about free speech, which you did in this week's Jewish News.
Yes.
Particularly in regard to the Q&A controversy that occurred last week.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So what's your take on free speech?
Here's my I'll tell you actually very interesting, because we were just talking about the shul. Last week in shul, I gave a sermon on the Q&A, because it was just following the spate of terror attacks in Kuwait and in Tunisia and in France. And I linked it to the Q&A and spoke about how free speech, I believe, if abused and misused, can actually lead to violence. One of the congregants came to me afterwards in the Kiddush and said, look, Rabbi, wonderful sermon. Why don't you share it? Why don't you send it to the Jewish News? I said, it's a great idea, but there's only one problem. He said, what's that? I said, I never write my sermons down. I like to talk to the audience and look them in the eye. But he convinced me, and I put pen to paper and spoke to Zeddy Lawrence of the Jewish News. And he said, you're welcome to put in an op-ed if you want and base it on your sermon, which I did. And that's where it comes in. Look, my take is free speech is not free. That's my opening paragraph. And I think that... free speech must have boundaries because if misused, you can really poison the minds of vulnerable people and tip them over the edge towards violence and towards fundamentalism. And that, in my view, is just not on in our society at all. shouldn't be on in any society.
So there is a tipping point, you think, between like the Section 18C. You mentioned 18C.
That's right. That's right.
Which is really what it's all about, in a sense, is free speech versus what we can do to keep down.
That's right. And don't get me wrong, Henry, I'm all for free speech. I use it every week from the pulpit. Everyone's entitled to their views and their opinions, and it may be robust and highly expressive, but it cannot be an incitement to violence. And as soon as that red line is crossed, to me, it's an abuse of free speech and shouldn't be tolerated.
I totally agree with you on that. And there is a lot of controversy still on Q&A. I watched it this week again, and they're still going on about it.
Yeah.
And it's caused a real furor, especially with the ABC getting the brunt of the... Yeah. Anyway, we won't go any further on that. But you are very active in interfaith relations.
Yeah.
In what way do you do that?
Well, my involvement in interfaith relations actually started in my former synagogue, which was the Northeastern Jewish Center. Mm. I was there for 6 years.
Yeah,
as a very, very young rabbi. And one of the founding members there, a lovely fellow, suggested that I get involved in the Manningham Interfaith Network.
Yes.
And I readily agreed and met some wonderful, wonderful people. And I found that it was an important opportunity to build bridges between people of different faiths. If you look across in the Middle East and other places in the world, sadly and tragically, religion has become the fuel that divides and that causes dissension and often violence. So my take on it is, well, let's take religion for what it was intended to be and use it to unite us. And that's not to mean that I will agree with what the priest or the imam have to say. Obviously, we have fundamentally different views, but we can still get along. And it's in that context that I began attending various forums representing the Jewish faith on a whole multitude of issues. And more recently, when I was heading the Rabbinical Council of Victoria, we actually established a set of guidelines that would act as guidelines for rabbis when engaging in interfaith dialogue. What are our boundaries? What should we be doing? What should we not be doing? What should we be discussing? Should we go into theology? Should we not go into theology? And those types of things become important because they become the ingredients towards establishing those bridges.
That's very important.
Yeah.
We're about to bridge into the next segment.
Wonderful.
Because it's been great to have you on this segment.
Yes.
We're coming back with you.
Thank you.
And we're going to discuss more topics.
Looking forward.
We'll be back in a moment with Rabbi Yaakov Glasman.